Get ready for what might be the most incredible, against all odds, real-life rescue story ever captured on film. This is the story of miracle workers who moved heaven and earth to save 12 young Thai soccer players and their coach trapped for weeks deep inside a rapidly flooding cave. When monsoon rains block the exit path for the kids on a routine outing, rising waters push them deeper into miles of twisting pitch-dark passageways. What unfolds is an epic life-and-death battle to beat infinite dangers and long odds. More than 10,000 people, divers, medics, military from around the globe, unite in a desperate bid to bring home 13 lost souls before time runs out. This is a white-knuckled ride of non-stop suspense as brave cave divers inch through claustrophobic nooks and crannies on a mission no one thinks will work. It's an emotional roller coaster as hearts break and hope dims with each setback over the 17 grueling days. And ultimately, it's a soaring testimony to what human beings can do when compassion binds them together. So, the 12 young soccer players and their coach decided to explore the Tham Luang cave complex to celebrate one of the boys' birthday after soccer practice. They had no idea that a sudden and torrential rainstorm was about to block their exit. As night fell and the boys didn't return from their adventures, panicked parents gathered at the cave entrance. They knew their kids enjoyed exploring those tunnels as many young people did, but the downpour caused flash flooding inside the tunnels, sealing all possible exits. The parents begged authorities to search for the missing boys. Local rescue teams ventured in, but were blocked by rising floodwaters less than a half mile inside. As day turned to night, hope of finding the boys alive began to fade. On day three, a British expat named Vern Unsworth, who knew the Tham Luang cave better than most, arrived to help. Vern was known as the Ba Farang, or the Crazy Foreigner, for his daring cave explorations over the past 6 years. He advised that specialized cave rescue divers were the boys' only hope. His urgent note to the Thai government pleading for expert help would prove to be a pivotal moment in the rescue operation. On the second day of the intense Thai cave rescue mission, the Thai Navy SEALs bravely jumped in, but the rising floodwaters threw a wrench in their plans. Seeing the unique challenge, Vern quickly pushed the Thai Minister of Sports and Tourism to bring in the world's best cave rescue divers. In a hurried note, Vern wrote, "Get in touch with these divers. They're the absolute best." At the top of the list was 56-year-old Brit Rick Stanton, a legend known for his daring escapades and his gear held together by duct tape. By Rick's side was his longtime diving buddy, 59-year-old John Valanthan. Rick brought courage, while John added smarts and careful navigation to the mix. But wait, there's more to this story. We'll get to the other divers soon. Before we dive back in, don't forget to hit that subscribe button, drop a like, and leave a comment. I promise to respond. Now, back to the unfolding drama. And get this. What if I told you that Rick's Thai girlfriend, Amp Siriporn Bangnoen, was from the exact northern region where the trapped boys were? Fascinating, isn't it? Now imagine this group of middle-aged buddies heading to Thailand with their unique skills, ready to take on a real-world rescue like never before. Intriguing, right? When Rick and John rolled onto the scene on day five, chaos reigned supreme. In a sea of crisply uniformed Thai Navy SEALs, these two scruffy Brits, sporting shorts, t-shirt, and flip-flops, seemed oddly out of place. Doubt hung thick in the air as the SEALs eyed them skeptically. Tensions hit a boiling point when Rick and John, adamant about diving right into the flooded cave, clashed with the SEALs, who deemed it too perilous. The disagreement reached a fever pitch, but the Thai governor settled the dispute definitively. No diving just yet. Reluctantly, Rick and John backed off. Little did the SEALs grasp the brilliance concealed beneath the facade of this peculiar pair. On day six, with slightly improved conditions, Rick and John geared up, ready to brave the murky, chest-deep waters at the cave's entrance chamber. The moment they plunged in, fierce currents swept them away. The white water conditions lived up to the cave's name, Tham Luang, meaning Great Cave. Battling relentless currents, they pressed forward through waters with near-zero visibility, blinded beyond their diving lights. Navigating through telephone wires, cables, and debris, made progress painfully slow. After hours of underwater navigation, they surfaced in Chamber 3, a critical midpoint camp for the SEALs. A momentary surge of hope hit when Rick and John spotted a group of men. Could this be the team? Excitement turned to disappointment as they realized it was pump workers who had dozed off on a sandbank unknown to anyone. Swift action was essential to dive them out before Chamber 3 flooded entirely. Despite dealing with terrified adults, the evacuation proved complex, disorienting, and downright perilous. Close calls with the stranded workers underscored the daunting challenges, casting a shadow over the once optimistic belief of rescuing the young boys alive. Hope dwindled rapidly as the reality of finding the boys slipped further away. As day 7 dawned, relentless rains pounded the mountains, thrusting water levels inside the cave to dangerous heights. The floodwaters, inching closer to Chamber 3's limited dry ground, where the pump workers narrowly escaped, turned what was already a dire race against time into a full-blown crisis. From every corner of the globe, volunteers flocked in. A squad of 30 American military personnel descended from Okinawa, Japan, carrying supplies donated by tech giants in Silicon Valley and the ever-innovative Elon Musk. Then, in a twist of fate, enter Saman Gunan, a retired Thai Navy SEAL and triathlete. Despite hanging up his uniform, the call to action propelled him back into service. There was no sitting idly by when the boys needed saving. Meanwhile, a coalition of hydrogeological experts, geologists, and engineers toiled relentlessly, urgently diverting water away from the cave entrance. Their mission? To seal off streams and cracks in the mountainside that fed into the inundated tunnels. Enter Belgian cave diver Ben Remenants, bearing an ominous warning based on his own harrowing experience battling intense currents inside. His verdict? Conditions were perilous, and the rescue window was swiftly closing. Come day 8, nearly a week of unrelenting downpour had cast a shadow of dread over the camp. Parents broke down, tears flowing freely as they prayed before makeshift shrines outside the cave entrance. Despite medical assurances that surviving 8 days without food was possible, the worsening floods dimmed hopes of finding the boys alive. Then, unsettling rumors circulated. A renowned monk from Myanmar prophesied that the boys would be found, but the rescue would claim 2 lives. This chilling prediction sent shivers through everyone, yet it sparked a supernatural belief that the boys would indeed be saved. A glimmer of hope emerged when morale was at its lowest. The question lingered: would the prophecy of 2 lives be fulfilled? The air was thick with uncertainty and determination. On the crucial day 10, seasoned divers Rick and John geared up for a dive deeper into the flooded cave than anyone had dared before. Battling against strong currents, they carefully laid guide ropes, aiming for the T-junction, a spot nearly a mile from the entrance. After 3 exhausting hours, covering 800 meters, they reached Chamber 3, the SEALs' frontline camp. However, the elusive T-junction and Pattaya Beach, presumed to be the refuge for the stranded team, still lay ahead. Thanks to the Americans pumping in nitrox breathing mixtures for longer dive times, the thin lines of rope extending over a mile into the dark maze allowed little room for mistakes. Each move was crucial, as one misstep could lead to disaster. Despite alarms warning them to turn back and avoid exceeding safe air limits, Rick felt a strong urge to press on into the unknown. His gut feeling, a reliable guide in the past, led him forward. Ignoring the warnings, he continued further up the flooded passage. Then, a surprise. A foul smell of death filled the air around the next bend. Bracing for a grim scene, they pointed lights and cameras, only to be met with an astonishing discovery. In the darkness, Rick saw a sudden flashing light, a sign of life. Thin voices responded to John's calls, revealing that 13 kids were still alive. "Brilliant!" John cried. Overwhelmed but composed, Rick knew that the miracle they hoped for required a safe retracing of their route. "Believe," he told himself. Though emaciated, the boys clung to life on day 10. The question lingered: could they hold on until rescue teams somehow reached them over a mile deep inside the monsoon-flooded tunnels? The stakes were high, and the race against time continued. When expert divers Rick and John found the missing boys alive after 10 days trapped in a flooded cave in Thailand, it was an incredible moment. But getting them out would be extremely perilous. The boys were hungry, weak, and in terrible condition. John tried lifting their spirits, but time was running out. They had to leave the boys behind for now and dive out to relay the news. The world celebrated as the boys' families rejoiced at the miracle. But Thai Navy superiors relegated Rick and John to an advisory role, taking charge themselves. Tragically, ex-Navy SEAL Saman Gunan died during a food delivery trip, underscoring the danger. Authorities considered drilling or pumping out water, but nothing worked. With options dwindling, Rick and John were called back in. They proposed sedation and diving the boys out, an unprecedented idea. Expert cave diver. Dr. Harry Harris was extremely skeptical, but came to help. After assessing the crisis firsthand, he was convinced there was no other way. More cave diving specialists were recruited internationally. Finally, but warnings came that the team could face legal consequences if anything went wrong. Something like going to prison. On the eve of the rescue, Dr. Harris had grave doubts, thinking the boys might drown. But he persevered, inspired by his late father's example of courage and generosity. With 13 lives on the line, there was no walking away. Now that Dr. Harris and additional divers from around the world had joined the rescue mission after the boys were found, the Minister of Interior grilled Dr. Harris about the proposed plan. He asked many questions about the drug dosages required to sedate the boys for the treacherous dive out. Dr. Harris emphasized that this was his best estimate for something unprecedented. He was open to better ideas, but there were none. Translator Josh Morris conveyed the stark reality to the minister. The only guarantee I can give you is that if you don't dive, everyone will die. I don't envy you, sir. Both choices are terrible, but one is worse than the other. Then on day 15, though still lacking official approval, the team formulated a comprehensive rescue plan, mapping out transport, packaging of the boys, positioning of gear. Key details like positive pressure masks were secured, allowing multiple trips with the limited equipment. Finally, Thai authorities gave the green light at 2 a.m. on day 16. After a sleepless night full of doubts, Dr. Harris persevered, inspired by his late father's example of courage and generosity in crisis situations. There was no walking away with 13 lives on the line. The rescue team assembled that morning was composed of Dr. Harris, Rick and John, Vern, Maxim and Ivan from the Eurodivers, Clicks from Belgium, cave explorers Josh Morris, Jason Mallinson and Chris Jewell, and expert Chinese diver Tan Xiaolong. With the world watching and weather threats looming, they prepared to commence the impossibly daring rescue plan, unsure if the sedated boys or any rescuers would survive the claustrophobic 2.5-hour underwater journey through the jagged, murky cave passageways. To execute the daring rescue plan, Dr. Harris and Jason Mallinson carefully administered a combination of drugs to the boys to induce unconsciousness for the treacherous 2.5-hour dive. They used a fast-acting anti-anxiety medication called Xanax, as well as atropine to reduce salivation. This was followed by carefully calibrated injections of the anesthetic ketamine to put each boy fully under. The team was split up into groups stationed at different chambers. One squad supported the divers coming in and out with the boys along the route, providing cylinder and mask changes when needed. Another group set safety lines and managed communications to Chamber 3, where a medical team awaited to receive the boys. At one point in the tense process, Jason nearly injected himself with ketamine instead of the next boy, but caught himself just in time. The icy floodwaters and tight passages made conditions extremely difficult. John had to switch out an oxygen cylinder for one boy during the exit dive, since he had issues with breathing properly when sedation wore off a bit. Before arriving at Chamber 3, there was a section so tight that only one body could fit through at a time. So the divers had to first push each boy through feet first, then follow behind. In Chamber 3, a stretcher team was at the ready. Almost 200 rescuers mobilized to carry each boy on a sked stretcher, pulling rope lines the final distance out of the cave to waiting ambulances. After successfully evacuating four of the boys that first grueling day of the rescue operation, it was decided to pause and regroup before bringing out the remaining teammates still awaiting rescue deeper in the cave tunnels. On day 18, after heavy rains the night before, the divers faced a difficult decision at their pre-dive briefing. With rising floodwaters, some questioned if they should risk the dive that day or wait, but they knew this could be their last chance to save the remaining wild boars and coach. So they suited up and set off, first taking the coach. But Chris ran into trouble when he let go of the guide rope in the murky, final flooded section. Groping in darkness, he grabbed an electrical cable, following it until he surfaced, lost in an unknown chamber. Luckily, Jason and Dr. Harris were passing through and found both Chris and his precious cargo. They got the child to safety while Chris gathered himself before exiting. The last wild boar posed another problem. Mark's face was too small for any of the diving masks. After several failed attempts getting various masks to seal with water leaking in, they had to take a risky gamble on a flimsy pink mask. Jason went painstakingly, slowly, and carefully. In triumph, as the final seals emerged, the Chamber 3 celebration was cut short when pumps burst, rapidly flooding the area. The seals just barely escaped by holding their breath underwater. It seemed the cave spirits were ready for the intruders to leave. Tearfully, parents thanked the divers for giving their children a second chance at life. But amidst the jubilation, Dr. Harris received tragic news. His father had passed away that very day. As Harris absorbed the shock of his father's sudden passing, condolences poured in from around the globe. He found strength and purpose reflecting on his dad's rich life and taking pride in their joint life-saving legacy. The divers were celebrated internationally as heroes. Reception ceremonies welcomed them in Thailand, Australia, and beyond. They met Queen Elizabeth, British Prime Minister Theresa May, and the Thai King and Thai Prime Minister Dr. Harris, Rick, John, and all the rest divers received honors. Samon, the retired Thai Navy, once said to his wife that we never know when we're going to die, urging us to cherish every day. His courage will forever be remembered. RIP Vet Sam. That wraps up today's video. Thank you for tuning in. If you enjoyed the content, don't forget to hit the subscribe button, give it a thumbs up, and share this compelling story to inspire someone. Your support means the world.